Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Grace Valley Christian Center's Adult Sunday School. Let's open in prayer. Heavenly Father, the cry of the Reformation was sola scriptura, because it is only in your word that we have an objective revelation from you that tells us what we are to believe concerning you and what duty you require of us. And so there is no more important question that we can consider than your word. And we pray that as we look at this book, begin looking at this book this morning, you would help me to speak clearly, and you would help all of us, Lord, to think carefully about your word, that we would have a solid foundation, Lord, as the psalm says, how firm a foundation we have, O God, in your blessed word. And so we ask your blessing on this time, in Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're beginning a new series on a book called Thy Word is Truth by E.J. Young. He was the Old Testament scholar and Hebrew scholar that Pastor had as a teacher at Westminster Theological Seminary. And I highly recommend this book, and a tip of my hat to Mr. Roby, because he's the one who told me about this book, and it was a wonderful thing to read. You can easily find it on Amazon or a number of other places, so if you want to get a copy, it's encouraged. And now I've got to figure out why this, there we go. So, Young states the purpose at the beginning of his book very, very clearly. He says, to acquaint the intelligent layman with the biblical doctrine of inspiration and to convince him of its importance. Of course, there's an implicit question in that statement, isn't there? But we will assume that you're all intelligent laymen. He doesn't state a purpose for unintelligent laymen. So we'll just assume that this applies to all of us. And we have to remember Article 19 from the Chicago Statement on Biblical Inerrancy, which Mr. Roby showed you during the previous series here, which says, we affirm that a confession of the full authority, infallibility, and inerrancy of Scripture is vital to a sound understanding of the whole of the Christian faith. We further affirm that such confession should lead to increasing conformity to the image of Christ. And of course, as we'll see later today, Christ himself thought that the Word of God was infallible and inerrant. And so, in one sense, we are more conformed to Christ right away if we believe that. But of course, in another sense, if we believe that, it's going to affect how we read the Word, how we respond to the Word, especially when we disagree, when our in our nature want to disagree with it. And so all of that will help us to be conformed to the nature of our Lord and Savior. So remember also that the Westminster Confession of Faith starts with the Word of God, because it's only there, as I prayed, that we have an objective, authoritative revelation from God. We aren't left to be thinking about our own subjective ideas about God. We have an objective standard that we can go to. And just to remind us of what it says in chapter 1, paragraph 4, the confession says, the authority of the Holy Scripture, for which it ought to be believed and obeyed, depends not upon the testimony of any man or church, but wholly upon God, who is truth itself, the author thereof. And therefore, it is to be received because it is the Word of God. So we can go through all sorts of apologetic arguments and so forth, which are good for strengthening our faith, and they can be good for making someone who claims to be an atheist or an agnostic uncomfortable with their agnosticism or atheism. But at the end of the day, if your faith rests on any kind of argument made by any human being or group of human beings or any amount of evidence, you've got a faulty faith. You have a faulty foundation. And so the foundation for our faith, of course, is the Word of God, which the Spirit works in us to bring to our mind as being the true and very Word of God and fully authoritative. Now, much of modern theology uses the same terminology as historical Reformed theology, but endues it with a new, completely unbiblical meaning. And this is part of why this is such an important topic for us. It's like having the signposts changed. I took this picture. This is from World War II, and it was in England, and they were going around changing all of the signposts so that if the Germans invaded England and they tried to look at the signs to see where to go, they'd be hopelessly confused and be going in the wrong direction. And if my memory of history is right, the same thing was done in Europe by the Germans. They kind of change signposts around. So we can't trust what somebody says necessarily. We need to go back to the original map, the original guidebook, which is the Bible itself. And I was very strongly had this brought to my mind a couple of years ago when Dr. Faber and I were witnessing to a man who had come to our church a few times and was interested in the church and so forth. And we didn't think he even claimed to be a Christian, but as we got to talking with him, we found out that he claimed to have been a Christian for many, many years, and he actually knew a great deal about the Bible. He could quote quite a number of things and so forth. And as we got to talking with him, he readily agreed that the Bible was the Word of God, but then later it came out, well, but it's not the words of God. Of course, Dr. Faber and I are sort of scratching our heads wondering, well, what exactly do you mean by this distinction? And it turns out he had drunk deeply of modern theology, which with many, many churches around us, they will look to Karl Barth as being the ultimate theologian of the 20th century. And Karl Barth, I don't think, was a Christian. Plain and simple. And he would say that the Word of God didn't become the Word of God until you read it and you had an experience with it and so forth. So it all boils down to pure subjectivity. And that's the kind of thing we want to watch out for. They use the same terminology, but it doesn't mean the same thing, and you need to be careful. So here's what Young says about the danger. What makes the present situation difficult and fraught with such dire consequences for the well-being of the church is that the signposts have been tempered with, so that they intentionally lead one astray. The guidebook and map, it is true, remain the same, and to those who will read and understand, their message is clear, for they were given by the Lord of the church, who is truth itself and cannot lie. So we need to be able to turn to the Bible, and that means we should first and foremost give great praise and glory to God for placing us in a church where we have a pious and learned pastor who does not give in to looking at all of the little waves of modern theology and getting pulled one way or another, but stays fixed on the Word of God and helps us to stay fixed on the Word of God and to understand it properly. So Young goes on to say, the real issue, as the present book will seek to make clear, is that modern man no longer is ready to listen to the voice of the one living and eternal God, but prefers rather the changing sands of human opinion for the foundation upon which to build his religious life. And that is so evident in so many different ways. You know, if you try and think of examples, it's not that hard, but it's just one example. How many people today who call themselves Christians, and maybe some of whom really even are Christians, will say they don't believe in an eternal hell? And when you ask why they don't believe in an eternal hell, it has nothing to do with biblical exegesis, obviously, because if you go to the Bible, of course, what does it speak of? An eternal hell. But what's their reason for not wanting to believe in an eternal hell? Because they don't like it, and they don't believe that a fair and just and wonderful God would do such a thing. That's just sloppy, horrible thinking and a lack of understanding the Word of God and a lack of having reverence for the Word of God and a lack of holding the Word of God up as our ultimate standard for what it is we are to believe and how we are to act. And so we want to listen to God, not to men. And we look back at Peter and the other apostles, we're told in Acts, replied to the Sanhedrin, we must obey God rather than men. And we should have the same cry at all times. So let's take a look at some different modern views, with modern here being used very loosely. It goes back quite a ways, of the Bible. First of all, the Reformation. And the cry there, of course, was sola scriptura. And the Reformers believed the Bible to be the ultimate authority and that it should be its own interpreter. That's called the analogy of faith. So Scripture interprets Scripture, right? They also believe that it should be interpreted literally. Now, that's one of those words I almost hesitate to put up, because people use that word in different ways. And of course, one of the legitimate uses of the word literal is to say that the literal meaning of something is, and by that you mean that when Jesus said, I am a door, that he literally meant he was a physical door or something. And that's not what we mean by the literal interpretation of Scripture. We mean as literature. You try and find out what the original author intended. So when Jesus said, I am the door, what was he saying? He was using it as a metaphor, right? And we understand metaphorical, we understand poetic, we understand hyperbolic speech, all of these things. That's the literal interpretation that the Reformation was talking about. And they also thought that it should be interpreted according to the grammatical historical method. And all of this, the bottom line is believing, is founded on a belief that there is one and only one correct interpretation of Scripture, and it is whatever it was the author had in mind when it was written. There may be many applications, but there's one interpretation that is correct. Now, after the Reformation, you had modernism, sort of in the 19th century here, or higher criticism, or the scientific study of the Bible. And the bottom underlying thing there was that it rejects the inerrancy of the Bible and places man's reason as the ultimate authority. So You know, there were all kinds of things that they used to say that have been overturned by archaeology, where if you go back and look, I didn't bother to come up with a list of examples, but if you go back and look on books on biblical archaeology, you'll find examples of where people for 150 or 200 years were saying, well, the Bible's wrong here because that title was never used in the Roman Empire, you know, and so on, and then all of a sudden they dig something up in archaeology and find out, oh, no, that title was used, you know, or they say whatever. For example, one of the biggest examples, of course, comes about because for many, many years people were saying, well, if we had an older copy of the Bible, you know, up until the time of the Dead Sea Scrolls, the most recent extant copy of the Bible was from about 900 or 1000 AD, I don't remember exactly. And people were saying, well, like all other ancient documents, if we found one from the time of Christ, it would vary tremendously from the ones that we have now. And then, of course, along comes the Dead Sea Scrolls, and we find a whole bunch of stuff from the time of Christ, and there were no significant differences between them. So it kind of blew that whole idea out of the water. But nonetheless, the whole idea of the 19th century really was that man's reason is the ultimate authority. So if there's something in the Bible that doesn't make sense and it conflicts with whatever our current modern scientific ideas are or our current historical understanding of something, then the Bible must be wrong. And we can't stand with such an idea, such a view of the scriptures. And then you have the newer theological views, of which Karl Barth is a prime example, that say they want to keep the gains of the scientific study of the Bible. And Jung in the book asks the question, well, what exactly are these gains that we got from this scientific study of the Bible? But they want to keep those gains, but they realize that something had been lost. And so they want to recapture the deeper spiritual truths present in the text. Whenever you see a phrase like that, take warning. And be very leery of what comes next, right? Because when people start talking about the deeper spiritual truths of the Bible or something, what it usually means is they're getting ready to tell you that the Bible says something the Bible doesn't say. All right, so like all doctrines, we should get our doctrine of inspiration from the Bible itself. And just as a note, if you're looking in the book, the issue before the church is the title of this first large chapter. And I'm going to use that as the title for a number of slides. This chapter sort of gives an overview of what the book is going to do, and that's going to consume us for most of this morning, if not all. And then we'll go into some of these things in more detail as we move on from there. So, like all of our doctrines, we need to get our doctrine of inspiration from the Bible itself. We don't look somewhere else to find out what inspiration is. We look at the Word of God. And inspiration in this context is perhaps a poor choice of words. It does not mean inspired in the sense we often use that word, where we speak, for example, about an actor or a musician giving an inspired performance or something. The word in 2 Timothy 3:16, where we get this, is theopneustos, which is a passive and it means breathed out by God. So it's not inspired in the sense of somebody giving an inspired performance. It means inspiration in the sense of breathing, but it's maybe expiration would be a better word here. It's breathed out by God. And so if we look at some different translations, you'll see the word inspiration in the King James. In the NIV, we read that all scripture is God-breathed. That's better. And in the ESV, as is commonly the case, you get something that's even a more literal translation of the Greek. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching and so on. But there's dangerous translations out there as well, not that they're necessarily wrong, but they can lead to wrong conclusions. So as an example, just comparing, here's our NIV again, and it says all scripture is God-breathed and so on. Then you look at the ASV and it says every scripture inspired of God is also profitable for teaching and so on. Now, English teachers out there, tell me, is the subject of this sentence every scripture? Or is the subject of this sentence every scripture inspired of God? If I put the inspired of God in there as a limitation on the subject, we've got a problem because it sort of implies that there are scriptures that are not inspired of God. Now, maybe we're reading too much into what the translator meant if we do that. Maybe inspired of God is not supposed to be taken as part of the subject. I can't say, but it certainly looks like it to me, but I won't pin that on the person because I don't know. So every scripture inspired of God, though, is that the same as all scripture? Well, again, it depends on what you think the subject is. So we need to be careful because even things that are not necessarily wrong can lead to misleading ideas. We need to be very precise and clear about these ideas or we'll have problems. So let's take a look at what the Bible says, at least in brief. The Old Testament speaks of the word coming out from God. A very famous passage, of course, is in Isaiah 55, as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth, that will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. Now, of course, this passage doesn't specifically identify the word that comes out of God's mouth with the inscripturated word that we have, but we get that elsewhere, so this is fine. And of course, how would we know it if it wasn't, unless we were there when God spoke it to us? So. And the Old Testament speaks of God putting his word in the mouth of his prophets. We read, for example, in Jeremiah 1:9, "Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, 'Now I have put my words in your mouth.'" And then in 1:17 of Jeremiah, we read, "Stand up and say to them, whatever I command you." So God, the picture here is very clear. We see that the word that goes out from God's mouth is efficacious. It accomplishes what he sent it to accomplish. And he put that word in the mouths of his prophets and commands them to go forth and speak it and to write it. And that is the word that we have. And in the New Testament, we read in Matthew 4:4 that Jesus answered them, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." And how do we know the words that come from the mouth of God? Because it is written. Because they are part of the written record of God's prophets and teachers. So as Young says, the scriptures came into existence in an utterly unique way. They and they alone of all writings were breathed out of the mouth of God. And so we need to have this kind of a clear view of Scripture as we read it and study it daily, that this book is unique. It's not just special. It's not just wonderful. It's not just maybe even the best book. It is those things. But it is absolutely unique. It is the only book man has that was breathed out by God himself. And when we pick it up to read it, we need to have that kind of reverential attitude about what it is that we're getting ready to read. This is the Word of God, the one who spoke and this universe came into existence. That's whose word we're getting ready to read. And in 2 Peter 1:21, we're also told more about this. He says, "For prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." And that's a good translation of the Greek. This doesn't tell us all that we might want to know. God doesn't satisfy our curiosity about the process that he used for inspiring the scriptures. But in some sense, these men were carried along by God. And we'll talk about this more later, but it's not a wooden idea of just taking dictation. Calvin and others used the word dictation, but they didn't mean it in the sense of somebody just sitting there and being, you know, listening to what was being said and typing it down. Because the different authors of Scripture all have their own style. They all have their own level of education and background and experiences, and that comes out in their writings. And yet, in some mysterious way, which God has not chosen to reveal to us, they were carried along by the Holy Spirit such that what they wrote was, in fact, the very words of God. Not just the general idea, or not just some revelation of a picture, like God gives you a dream, and then you go and tell people what that dream meant and interpret and explain it or something. No, it was much, much more than that. And we're also told in John 10, 35 and 36, Jesus said, "Is it not written in your law?" And it's important to note here that he calls it the law, but he quotes from a psalm. Okay, so we'll come back to that in a second. "Is it not written in your law, 'I have said you are gods'?" If he called them gods to whom the word of God came, "And the scripture cannot be broken." That's the important phrase we want to see here. What about the one whom the Father sets apart as his very own and sent into this world? So he's saying, "Is it not written in your law?" But he's quoting the Psalms. So he means the law to be a word that's sort of held as, it's a litotes. It's an idea that represents the whole. I can't think of the word right now. So a little piece being used as a reference for the whole. And he's saying the scripture cannot be broken. So Young notes on this, it would seem that his purpose was to attribute to the scriptures a legal or authoritative character and thereby to establish them as writings to which appeals such as he was then making might legitimately be directed. So in other words, if you use a verse or a scripture passage correctly, Even though you only cite one scripture or something, you don't have to look at the whole thing. If you've used it correctly, the idea of using it as a proof text is a proper thing to do. Jesus himself did it. A lot of modern theologians disparage the idea of a proof text quite significantly, but you see it all through the Bible. Now, we have to be careful doing it, of course, because you can certainly pull verses out of context and get things out of them that are not at all what was intended. But nonetheless, the Bible is where we turn to learn what it is we are to believe. So we must ask ourselves then, is this Bible true? If it's where we turn, is it true? Well, if it is, then it should be true about what it says about itself. So if we look at the Bible to see what it says about itself, if it's true, then that should also be true. If it isn't reliable in what it says about itself, then what about other doctrines? And the point here is you can't pick and choose. There are people who will say to you, the Bible contains the Word of God. But we have to somehow get in and ferret out what the Word of God is in there. And the rest of it, we kind of say, well, that's not the Word of God. But the minute you do that, how do you know which part is the Word of God and which part isn't the Word of God? Where do you get that information? And the answer is nowhere. You make it up out of your own head. And so, in other words, you're making up what Scripture is. You know, it contains an awful lot of words, right? If I just pull words out and start throwing them together, I can make it say anything I want to make it say. And in fact, if I pull out portions of verses and throw them together, I can make it say anything I want it to say. So it either is or it is not the Word of God. You can't be picking and choosing and having both ways here. And there are only two possible ultimate standards for truth. We've discussed this before in Sunday school, and it's a little bit surprising when you first think of this idea, but go home and think about it if you're not convinced. There are only two standards for truth, ultimate truth: human reason or divine revelation. Either you accept what men say, either some individual man or collective, all of men collectively or whatever, or what you think, maybe you think you're the ultimate standard, or there's divine revelation. There is no alternative here to these two standards. And it seems pretty self-evident to me that if we have divine revelation available to us, that is certainly the standard that any reasonable person would choose for their ultimate standard for truth. I mean, human beings, by all admissions of anybody I've ever spoken with or read, are fallible and don't know everything. So fallible and ignorant beings, why would I take that as my ultimate standard when I have revelation from the God who created all things? That's a no-brainer, as they say. So in response to the frequently posited idea that we should approach the scriptures from a neutral position, so I'm sure you've heard this, somebody will say, well, you can't go and read the Bible just assuming it to be the Word of God. You've got to come at it from a neutral position and evaluate it to see whether or not it agrees with truth. Well, what have you just done? You've just set up human reason as the ultimate standard, because if you're evaluating the Bible to see whether or not it's true, what are you using as your standard for truth? For your standard of truth, you are using whatever men say is true through science and logic and whatever else and historical studies and so forth. I'm not saying they're all wrong or anything, but that is what you're using as your ultimate standard if you're saying, I'm going to pull the Bible up underneath that and I'm going to say, does it match up? But that's not the way we can do it. We can't do it that way. So Young notes, there can be no neutral position. We believe that either God is our creator and the one who alone gives meaning to all aspects of life, or that we are faced with the dismal gloom, I like that way of putting it, of relying upon the human mind as the ultimate point of reference and predication. There really is no choice, no other choice here, people. It's either God and his word, and it is his word, and it's our ultimate standard, or it's man. So when the Bible doesn't agree with science, guess who I believe? The Bible. Now, does that mean that there are not going to be places where it's extremely difficult to do that, where you find yourself just going, I don't understand, how can this be wrong, but the Bible's... Of course there are difficult areas, and there have been different ones throughout history, and it strengthens your faith to go look at the historical arguments and see how they have changed over the centuries, because you'll find that man said one thing and concluded the Bible was wrong, and then man changed and said something else, and now that part of the Bible was okay, but this part of the Bible is wrong, and you know, then man changed and thought something else, and so now a different part of the Bible is wrong. But the Bible is the standard, not us. And we're not doing something that nobody else does when we do that. If somebody wants to uphold human reason as the ultimate standard, to what do they refer to explain that human reason ought to be the ultimate standard? human reason. They argue circularly. This is circular logic on our part, we have to admit, but all ultimate standards will be defended in a circular fashion because all ultimate standards must refer to the ultimate standard for saying why you use them, all right? So there is no getting out of that circularity. So at this point, Young briefly addresses the question, is our faith in the Bible justified? And he points out that when compared with the literature from the ancient Near East, the Bible stands out like a fair flower in a dreary, barren desert. And he goes on with much more, but I liked this little quote. His point here is that this document, this Word of God is completely, you can't put other qualifiers on here, but I want to, unique. There is no other book in anywhere in the world, nor has there ever been, nor will there ever be, that is anything like the Bible. And if you simply open your eyes to that fact and read it with that idea, it is so evident and clear that you cannot possibly miss it. But the evidence isn't really the issue. Men will not believe independent of the evidence because their understanding is darkened because of their sin, and they will suppress the truth. That's the bottom line issue with not believing the Bible to be the Word of God. So the only way a person will truly be convinced that the Bible is the very Word of God is the inner testimony of the Holy Spirit, which requires that the person be born again. Now, I suppose theoretically God could inspire somebody to believe the Bible to really be His Word without causing the person to be born again. I don't know, but why that would happen, I don't know, but anyway. This is not belief without warrant. It is not an unwarranted belief at all. It is belief that is entirely consistent with all evidence and logic. I shouldn't have said all evidence, all proper or correct or true evidence. Obviously, there are some things that you may think you know that may conflict something in the Bible. But it is a belief that cannot be attained without new birth. Sin blinds the unbeliever. So we have to recognize when we try to talk to people about the Bible that, number one, we need to explain to them that if they want us to come at it with some sort of a neutral viewpoint, that no such thing exists. That's not physically possible. He has another quote I didn't use just because I was trying to limit the time, but where he says, if you come at the Bible from the point of view of unbelief, what will your conclusion be? Unbelief. So it's just not true that you can come at it from a neutral point of view. But we can point out that it's consistent with the evidence and so forth and the logic. You can even go through the historical record of how things have changed. And so there's all kinds of things to buttress your faith, but they aren't the basis or the ground of your faith. Now, Young concludes the chapter with the following statement. Having their vision obscured by the dense fog that modern theology is casting over the way, many do not realize that there is a crossroad. You know, the church has come up to a crossroad where you've got to be making a choice which way to go, but a lot of people don't even realize that choice is there. He says they are not aware that they must decide which road they will follow. Unless something is done, they will travel on, taking the wrong turning until the road leads them at last into the valley of lost hope and eternal death. And I think much of the modern church is there. Their hope is in doing good things for the world around us, in soup kitchens and, you know, all these kinds of things. Their hope is not in the eternal God. Their hope is not in that we read this morning in Hebrews, right? Their hope is not this hope of salvation because God has promised it and God has given an oath and God is true and God is able. That is not where their hope rests. So he goes on to say, pray God that He will awaken His people from their slumber. Pray that He will warn them of the dangers that lie ahead and the forsaking of His Word. And I would add, pray that we will take that to mind and take that to heart and be thankful for what we have here again with our daily reading list and with a pastor who knows the Word of God and with other godly men whom pastor has raised up and trained, and so that we can have the original guidebook instead of being dependent on these signposts that the modern world is changing and twisting around so that they point in all kinds of wrong directions. So, having established the basic doctrine and its importance, let's look at it more deeply so that we have a firm grounding in the truth and we can detect lies when we see them. You know, the example is often given of if you want to teach somebody how to detect counterfeit money, do you have them handle a whole bunch of counterfeit money? No. What do? You have them handle the real thing. Then you let them look at some counterfeits. But if they handle the real thing enough, then, you know, hopefully they can detect the counterfeit. So we want to know what the real thing is, what the real thing says. So Jesus told His disciples, he who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. Now, we weren't there, were we? Not one of us was there to hear Jesus Christ speak. So we have a problem. But fortunately, he gave the solution right here. He says, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. So Jesus is, in essence, here guaranteeing what the apostles will write after his death is infallible. And that's an important guarantee to us, because I don't want my faith to rest on Peter and Peter's ability to remember things that Christ said correctly and Peter's ability to properly interpret them. We can look at the life of Peter in the New Testament, can't we? I don't want my faith to rest on Peter, all right? Or Paul, or anybody else you can name. I want my faith to rest on God and the Word of God. And in this scripture, Christ is guaranteeing us that that's exactly what we have, that the Holy Spirit carried these men along as they were writing so that what they wrote was the Word of God. That doesn't mean they were infallible in anything else they did or said. They were not infallible. The Word of God is infallible. Now, the apostles were aware that what they were communicating was the Word of God. Look at what Paul, Silas, and Timothy wrote in 1 Thessalonians. They said, and we also thank God continually, because when you received the Word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the word of men. Now, that's how they received it. That's how they heard it, didn't they? It was the word of men spoken to them. But they didn't receive it as just the word of men. They received it as it actually is, the word of God, which is at work in you who believe. And the same thing is true in a slight, you know, in a different sense, obviously, when the word is preached. No preacher who stands at this pulpit is speaking the infallible word of God, except when they're reading the Bible. But God nonetheless speaks through the preacher, so that what we're hearing is not just the words of men. In a sense it is, in a sense it's not. Young notes, it should be clear that the entire argument rests upon the assumption that the written scriptures are trustworthy and accurate witnesses. And as we talked about a minute ago, God essentially guarantees us that's the case, so long as we have what was written, and we'll get to that in a later session. In other words, we read what Christ, the apostles, and others said in the scriptures, but can we trust this written record? Well, when the New Testament speaks of the scriptures, the word in Greek is usually graphe, which is usually speaking of the Old Testament. And in Romans 1, verse 2, Paul says the scriptures are holy. Now, why does he say they're holy? He says they're holy because they come from a thrice holy God. They are separate. They are distinct. They are different. They are unique. And in Romans 3, 2, Paul calls the scriptures the oracles of God. It says in the ESV or King James or in the NIV, the very words of God. The Greek word used there, the underlying root word, is logos, the same word that's used in John 1 for Christ himself. So we have Christ is the word of God incarnate, and the scriptures are the word of God inscripturated and written for us. There are a number of places where the words of Scripture are equated with the words of God, and we're only going to go through a very few of them, but Paul wrote in Romans 9, for the Scripture says to Pharaoh, I raised you up for this very purpose, and so on. So the important thing there is the Scripture says to Pharaoh. Now, this quotation is from Exodus 9:16, where the words are attributed to God himself. So notice, the Scripture says is equivalent to God says. There's an equivalence there. Also notice in Galatians, Paul wrote that the Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance, and so on. But in Genesis 22:18, these words are again attributed to God. So Scripture foresaw, God foresaw, or foreknew, foreordained, okay? And in Acts 4, after Peter and John were released by the Sanhedrin, they returned to the other disciples and prayed to God, saying in part, you spoke, so God spoke, by the Holy Spirit, through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? Quoting from Psalm 2, of course. So they're saying that God the Holy Spirit spoke through David in the scripture. And in Acts 28, Paul is speaking to the church in Rome and says, the Holy Spirit spoke the truth to your forefathers when he said through Isaiah the prophet, go to the people and say, you will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. Quoting the famous passage from Isaiah 6 that is quoted in multiple places in the New Testament. But Paul says that God the Holy Spirit spoke through the prophet, words that are recorded for us in Scripture. So we see here again the idea that, number one, God was speaking through the prophet, but also he then quotes things that these people had in writing in front of them, not necessarily right that instant, but had available to them in writing. And so clearly we see God speaking through the prophet, but that's written down, and it's in the Scriptures. And the Apostle Peter also states that what Paul wrote in the New Testament is Scripture. He says in 2 Peter 3:16, speaking of Paul, Paul's letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort as they do the other Scriptures to their own destruction. So clearly here saying that the things you have that Paul has written to you, the various letters to the churches and so forth that we have, those things are Scripture, just like the Old Testament. They are the Word of God. Paul was carried along by the Holy Spirit as he wrote these things. Now, the extent of inspiration, Jesus himself consistently treated the Scriptures as the ultimate authority. We've already seen John 10:35 where it says the Scripture cannot be broken. Well, why can't it be broken? Because it's the infallible Word of God, which cannot be broken. When Christ asked the Pharisees who Christ was the Son of, he said, "How is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord?" So David was speaking by the Spirit, and Christ is using this thing, well, how can it possibly be true? But it is true because it's in the Word of God. And Jesus answered Satan's temptations, of course, with saying, "It is written." And that settled the matter. So Jesus held up the Scriptures as the ultimate standard himself. And in John 5, Jesus was rebuking the Jews who persecuted him for healing on the Sabbath, and he said, "You diligently study the Scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life." He didn't say that isn't how you get eternal life. He just said, "You think this. These are the Scriptures that testify about me. If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But since you do not believe what he wrote," so you do not believe the Scriptures, "how are you going to believe what I say?" So Jesus clearly had a very, very high view of Scriptures. He was saying, if you don't believe those, you're not going to believe me. You're not going to be saved. You're not going to be possessing eternal life. When the Sadducees tried to trick him by asking about marriage, Jesus rebuked them, saying, "You are in error." And why were they in error? Because you do not know the Scriptures or the power of God. So we can avoid error, if you turn that around the other way, by knowing the Scriptures and believing them, which requires knowing or trusting also in the power of God, that whatever he has said, he can do. His arm is not too short. And during the Last Supper, our Lord declared, "The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him." Why? Because it's written, and the Scriptures can't be broken. So it's going to happen just exactly as it was written. And then on the Mount of Olives, he said, "You will all fall away. For," that's the reason he said this, "it is written." And he quoted from the Psalm. So again, he's saying the Scripture says it, therefore I know it's going to happen. I know it's true. So what is written in the Scriptures will and must happen because God has said it. When he was arrested, Jesus said, "Every day I was with you teaching in the temple courts and you did not arrest me, but the Scriptures must be fulfilled." And then he also said, do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the Scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen this way? So Jesus clearly considered the Bible to be unchangeably true in every detail, however painful the result was for him personally. And when he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, what did he pray? "May this be, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me." But then what? "But not my will, but thine be done." But also there was that "if it is possible." So it was an honest, legitimate prayer, but it was still in complete and total submission to the Word of God. Now, from the examples given so far, it's clear that the Bible itself claims to be the Word of God, and that Christ and his apostles considered it to be such and to be the final authority. And it's also clear that it wasn't just the general ideas or principles that came from God but were expressed in the fallible words of men, but the very words themselves. Scripture cannot be broken. It is written. It must be this way. It has to happen this way. So in Matthew we read, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, not a jot or a tittle, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. So we conclude that the doctrine taught in the Bible itself is that of plenary and verbal inspiration. Plenary, of course, meaning all of it. Verbal meaning the very words. Every single word came from God and is therefore infallible and inerrant precisely because God is infallible and inerrant. What is at stake here is what we think about God himself. And yet this doctrine is not accepted by the majority of Protestant ministers today. A vast majority, I would say, do not accept this doctrine. They may say they do in some sense. Again, they may say, oh yeah, the Bible's the word of God. But then you've got to dig deeper and find out what they mean by that statement. And the vast majority of them do not believe in the plenary verbal inspiration of the scriptures. And this kind of unbiblical thinking from the clergy goes back a long way. So we have just one more slide. I want to show you how far back this goes. And it goes even further, but there's a very famous case, which we've discussed before when we were doing Redemption Accomplished and Applied. But how many of you remember the Auburn Affirmation? This is what led ultimately to Machen founding, this whole dispute and controversy is what ultimately led to Machen founding Westminster Theological Seminary. But the PCUSA controversy that this is talking about culminated in a thing called the Auburn Affirmation in 1924, a document that objected to a 1910 requirement that ordained ministers affirm five essential doctrines. Now you have to think about this. This was signed up, do I have the number up here? Yeah, 1,274 ministers of the PCUSA signed this objecting to a call from their governing body that ministers who are ordained should agree with these five things. The inerrancy of the scriptures, that's first. And once you've not agreed to that one, the rest of these are going to follow sooner or later, okay? But the virgin birth and deity of Christ, the substitutionary atonement of Christ, the physical resurrection of Christ, the veracity of the miracles of Christ. This was in 1924. It's gotten worse, not better, since then. So when you give up on the authority of the Word of God, when you give up on the infallibility and the inerrancy of the Word of God, ultimately, all of your doctrines are going to fall other than the ones you want to keep. So what does that leave me with? Oh, God is love. God loves me. I'm going to heaven. Right? I like those, right? Most people like those three. So those three doctrines will stay, and then we call it a church, and we all get together, and we talk about how God loves us all, and God loves everybody, and we can talk about God's outrageous love that loves me no matter how I live, no matter how I want to live, no matter what I do or say, no matter what I believe, and that I'm all going, and we're all going to heaven, and we'll all be there together, right? And then we call that a church. And that is what's going on in most of the places around us that call themselves churches. So let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that we do have the infallible, inerrant, very words of God to direct us and guide us. And I pray that as we continue this series in the coming weeks, you would help us to get a firm grasp of that fact and of your truth, that we might live for your glory. And we ask your blessing on the rest of this day and our worship together in Jesus' name. Amen. You're dismissed.